The Politics program is brought to you, as always, by The Contender, the game of presidential debate, man. Head on over there right now and give yourself an opportunity to play what I consider to be the best game of 2016, probably because I made it. 2016 expansion. Speaking of 2016, the 2016 expansion, including quotes from Marco Rubio, Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, and of course, Lincoln Chafee are available right now for pre-order. Just head on over and make sure that you pick it up. Man, it's a great time. Everybody loves it. Try it for yourself if you have not already. Also, listeners to Politics, if you want your game signed and you buy it off thecontender.us, just make sure you throw our diamond logo that is less than, greater than, the brackets at checkout, and I'll sign anything that you get. It's a fun time. Be a part. And, of course, by patreon.com/JURY. That is where you directly support the show. And, man, did we hit a milestone. We indeed are at 423 patrons, which means that we got past the Nate Dogg milestone. Here. Oh. You know what? We're so far past it, we couldn't get the drop right. Thank you guys so much. $608 a podcast. We are well on our way to the $700 goal, which will bring along our own little In Your House mini tour. Very, very, very pumped. Thank you guys so much for the support. Again, patreon.com/JURY. But enough of all this jibber jabber. We got a guest for the show today. Let's go ahead and get into it. Politics, 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 politics. All right, everybody, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show. This is the Politics program. I am your friendly host, Justin Robert Young, once again joining you, but not alone this time. No. This is a one-mic show by and large. It's me running my filthy gums and telling y'all what happened in the week that was and what we can look forward to. However, this was, and I think even over the last 48 hours, went from kind of a boring week to a very, very interesting week. And to do that, to dice all that up, man, it's too much of a meal for one man. Let me welcome to the program. You know him as a senior writer for Tech Republic and CBS Interactive, but you can follow him on Twitter and all of his very, very learned musings at Dan Patterson. It is the eponymous Dan Patterson. Welcome.
Ha! That is the best introduction. Of all time.
Well,
that's
thank
a, also that's a great pod product, the intro, man. That's a fantastic little piece of production.
Well, I do appreciate the well wishes, but let's go ahead and just get in to the show. I mentioned boring week leading up to this. You know, here's how boring the week was. There was a picture where people couldn't tell whether or not Ted Cruz had his mouth closed or he was smiling, and everybody passed that off as something to focus on as we made our way through the week. There was no primary this week. There was no results. There was just a lot of think pieces. We continue to barrel toward a result in the New York primary, which kind of seems a little more wrapped up than anybody necessarily wants to have you believe. But in the last 48 hours, two things happened. Number one, we have a Democratic debate for which you are at, Dan. And we have a Donald Trump missive, the likes of which we are unused to. Let's start with that and we will get to the debate. Donald Trump, no stranger to writing things on the internet, writes something on the internet last night that was very interesting to me because he wrote it in the Wall Street Journal, the place where all, you know, stodgy old establishment people write their editorials. Let me ask America a question, a very politician-y, soaring, evocative of, you know, are you better off now than you were 4 years ago? Kind of bread and butter politics sort of lead off to it. The sub headline, how has the quote unquote system been working out for you and your family? No wonder voters demand change. This is something that could be on the bus for Bernie Sanders. Dan, what were your thoughts on Trump's Wall Street Journal opinion piece?
Well, you know, it is. There's no doubt that 2016, this campaign is the year of hard news, dirty politics, and civilized propaganda. And this kind of falls in the middle of all of those things. It's first of all, it's just tactical. Like, it's something that what Trump has been in the middle of doing in. It seems like he's doing it. I don't follow his campaign move by move, but it seems like he has kind of tossed aside some of his, some would say, amateurish campaign staffers and is in the process of growing up, or, you know, we would call it in the tech industry, pivoting, right? He's sure. Transitioning to like a more, I don't want to say presidential, but a more professional infrastructure, right? The beginning of this was his meeting a few weeks ago with the RNC establishment in D.C., and now he's in the process of building Trump the brand out from Trump the goofball we've seen to this point. I think that's what he's doing. So this story in the Journal is like a tactical piece of that strategy. How effective it is, I don't know. And I'm also only speculating. This is what I see, but like,
Well, I mean, but I agree with everything you've said. However, I think that you're brushing off how newsworthy the maturation of Donald Trump, the Trumpening, as I am calling it, is to this race, because you can make an argument, and I have repeatedly on this show, that if this is the Trump that shows up after Florida and not the same lunatic who's screaming and yelling about Megyn Kelly being unfair to him on Twitter, then this race probably is over.
Right? Yeah, he should have done this. They got spooked by the Cruz campaign's very competent infrastructure, and they're real, like, they are out to get delegates. And they got spooked by that. And if you're exactly right, if Trump had done this 6 months ago, then boom, no problem. He'd be soaring through to the nomination. He only got his act together right now.
And I think here's what's very fascinating about it, is that at some point, two people that are deeply flawed, even within the Republican electorate, Ted Cruz and Donald Trump, one of them was going to get a second look from the people. People that don't like them, that probably wouldn't in an abstract a year ago say, would you vote for one of these people? That when you put it in the context of, okay, against Hillary Clinton, when literally everyone else is out of the picture, now would you have an interest in voting for this person? One of them was going to get it. And I feel like Ted Cruz has kind of gotten it more than Donald Trump, largely because Donald Trump has pretty much been steadfastly obstinate in giving anybody a reason to give him a second look. And this, so let me break this down. This piece basically lays out is Donald Trump's. There are a couple layers to it. It is oniony. And here are the layers from bottom to top. There is a very surface layer element of Donald Trump saying, "Hey, this is Ted Cruz's strategy. He is now subverting the populace, and you now go back to the core strengths of the Donald Trump campaign, which is I can't be bought. The system is broken, and I am here to fix it." So vote for me as a protest. I am giving voice to your wondering whether or not that this world that we live in is indeed fair. And I am your raging id. He tones down the raging id to play up those last two things. The second level, which I think is almost more interesting, is that this is downright Bernie-esque. And he is looking toward you know, should he make his way past the Republican primary as their nominee against Hillary Clinton, he is saying, no, look, I can attract the Bernie heat on this because the word system is mentioned far more than the term establishment. Establishment is dog whistle for Tea Party people on the Republican side. System is a dog whistle for independents who are not in love with Hillary Clinton, which that's I think is theory. Very interesting. But this, and you can take any of these 3 points after I make this final one. I believe the medium is the message. And by going to the Wall Street Journal and not, let's say, to Facebook or an Instagram comment, he is saying to the establishment, I can play ball. I can be the guy that you want. You can have it both ways. I can be tamed enough that you can deal with me. I will not, you know, I'm not going to send the Wall Street Journal copy edit staff searching to find out whether or not Lion Ted is up or not. And yet he'll do it by saying he's here to tackle the establishment. Any of those 3 points ring true to you, or am I just full of it?
No, that's exactly right. I mean, he's making a tactical move that is aimed at a particular audience. And when, just like you said, when you speak on Facebook or Twitter, you're talking to a particular audience. In this case, he is targeting the readers of the Wall Street Journal with a very particular message, and you enumerated that just a minute ago. Like, this is about him saying, I need you, but you can count on me.
Yes. And again, I mean, for those of you who are unaware, and this is known certainly in political and journalism circles, but the Wall Street Journal opinion page, both their editorial board and who they are often the destination for op-eds like this, is the playground of the conservative Republican elite, right?
Well, it is known to be. It's conservative. And I mean, yeah, you could say the conservative elite if we're talking from like a broad perspective of America. Yeah, yeah. Economically, the opposite of marginalized, empowered.
Yes, secure. Yes. One might say disposable income.
Doing just fine.
They're doing all right. Don't worry about them. If you're worried about them, stop. Stop worrying about them. So that I found very, very interesting. It's going to be curious to see how Cruz hits back on it. You have to assume that he kind of saw this element coming, and at some point Trump would have to grow up. And if I'm Ted Cruz, I think the way that you steer against it is you say, hey, look, yet another complainer. Yet another person who wants to blame systems beyond his control for his failings. I think we've all had 8 years of that. It's called Barack Obama. Just find and replace the system with the Congress. And you can look forward to yet another 4 years of somebody who just simply can't get stuff done. Unlike me, I'm out there, you know, paying peanut butter sandwiches to volunteers so they can stand in line to make sure that all the delegates belong to us when it comes to Cleveland. That would be where I would go if I were Ted Cruz. If you were Ted Cruz, perish the thought, how would you react to the Trumpening?
Well, I can tell you the best way to think about the Cruz campaign is this. They want to win, and they're willing to do what it takes to win. That means they understood the process, and they have been working the process to their advantage. No one knows data like the Cruz campaign, and very few, although Trump is winning on social media. We've been tracking this for, you know, a good 6 months. And, I mean, Trump's just like he blows everyone away on Twitter, of course, with his following. But what the Cruz campaign knows how to do is translate data and social media into micro-targeting, which is the like canvassers, the people who will knock on your door, or the mailers that come in your mailbox, the phone calls.
all of that stuff is fine-tuned for you or a demographic like you. There are companies like there's this company L2, which sells all kinds of demographic information, and you can overlay it with tools like Nation Builder with other like social media information and pull profile pictures and really get to know, quote-unquote, the voter and target a message for that is like – it blows away even what the Obama people were doing in 2012. They're running simulations in various counties and like getting really, really targeted with their tactics. They run a campaign like people who want to win. And say what you will about the broader message of Ted Cruz's likability or what the polls say or even what the anti-Cruz messaging is.
Sure.
They play a game like people who want to win. And Trump is playing a game now like somebody who has been spooked into winning. So if I'm Ted Cruz, I don't worry so much about like what he's doing in like the most reactionary. Like I really am dead focused on getting those delegates in the second round. If he doesn't get the second round, I don't know what's going to happen. But I think he's looking at like, if I get those delegates in the second round, I'm in. So whatever Bozo wants to say in between then and now, fine, let him say it. Like I'm focused on delegates.
And by the way, there was a Nate Silver article that I couldn't find this morning, but I read last night about his revised pathway to Trump's final delegate count, which really took a hit in Wisconsin because they had initially forecasted Trump doing better in Wisconsin than ended up happening. It's going to be tough. Yeah. It's going to be, I mean, I think that there's a reason that like the messaging today from Trump world, which again is another element that you can see that adults might be in charge behind the scenes with Trump world. As you start to see, I mean, again, Wall Street Journal editorial, there's surrogates. They got Sarah Palin on message, shockingly. Today, to say that, you know, there would be great civil unrest should the nomination be taken away from Donald Trump in Cleveland. This is exactly what they want to get out there. This is a subversion of the will of the people. And should it continue to go on, there will be great problems, not only for the Republican Party, but also for the larger conservative movement. It's almost surprising. Like it's one of those things where you look at this campaign, which has always just been this sort of, for people who watch politics, this freak show element of like, how can they keep doing this? How can everything that he says just bounce off of him and be doing so well? But yet he carved himself such a narrow position in this low 30s to high 30s margin. That he missed his window to kind of make it different, to not go so hard on Ted Cruz and instead just declare victory over the establishment and start focusing on Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, it sounds like you're almost frustrated. I understand this with the man. You could have done it right.
And yeah, instead
you messed it up.
It's like he had a thing. And listen, again, this is not the show if you want to be impassioned about whether or not somebody should or shouldn't be president. Yeah, this is not the show for you. This is the show about people watching the game of chess and being frustrated when somebody misplays.
That's exactly it.
And that's something that I've been frustrated. You know, we did an episode 2 weeks ago about the lessons that Dusk Till Dawn, the Robert Rodriguez film, can teach us about the 2016 election. And the number one for Donald Trump was, are you so much of a loser that you can't realize when you've won? And that, I think, you know, he now realizes that. He is now acting like somebody that realizes it. Although he did have, he did forget that Joe Paterno was dead this week, which was another fun element. At some point, listen, I think, all right, here, let me ask you this. Do you think Donald Trump gets on some semblance of a stump speech, let's say before California, which will now be his biggest test?
I don't know. I don't know.
I mean, because that would be the final politicianing of Donald Trump, right? He literally, his stump speech from the very beginning has essentially just been his enemies list, where he just lists off things and people he doesn't like and makes fun of them. Now, I don't know. I think we could possibly see a Trump stump speech, which is mind-blowing to me that he could be corralled to that point.
He already kind of gives stump speeches. Like he gives campaign speeches and rallies where he just talks, and like that's a stump speech.
Well, yeah, I mean, but like you know what I'm talking about. I like top 10, the same 10 minutes, news of the week, and then the final 15 minutes that are always the same. Like that's stump speech.
Like, man, I've heard this speech so many times.
I know, but that's the one thing about Trump, and it's I think one of the elements that is kind of behind the scenes. If you've ever been a reporter, or you understand journalism. Is I think part of why he got covered so much is that you went to a Trump speech and you kind of didn't know what the hell he was going to say. And for political reporters who have to watch the same messaging over and over and over again, to a certain point, that was, you know, if not interesting, certainly something that, you know, would keep you awake. That and the fact that you could get, you know, killed at any moment because he's inciting rioters around you.
A historian would set me right, I'm sure, but it's not. Maybe not entirely unprecedented, but man, in the modern era, this type of behavior is pretty unprecedented. It's also it's disheartening too. I really want to believe that we can talk about issues that are challenging and difficult, like civil adults, and disagree about things, but still respect each other.
We're past there.
I feel like a naive idiot for thinking this, but like. I want to believe we can do that, and seeing our not just the political process, but like the unrest and the discord and the way on both sides, on the left, right, and in the purple middle, people are just dicks to each other.
Yeah. Well, that gives me a perfect segue, because to believe all of my staunch blue, my Democratic friends on Twitter. Last night on CNN, this is how the adults do it. This is how the civilized folk have political discourse. The Democratic debate, Bernie Sanders versus Hillary Clinton on stage in the Brooklyn Naval Yards. Or is it Naval or Navy?
Navy.
The Brooklyn Navy Yards. Dan, you were on hand, or at least in the appropriate media-sanctioned paddock that they roped everybody into.
Yeah. That's as far as it let us go.
Exactly. God forbid you breathe the same air as the candidates. What were your general thoughts? And then we'll get into what I thought about it.
It's a beautiful venue, and it's no doubt there's no doubt why Brooklyn was chosen as the venue. The New York primary, of course, this coming Tuesday, but both Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton have long ties to the state. And Brooklyn itself is going through this cultural renaissance right now. The Navy Yards is right next to Dumbo, which has been home to Etsy and Dropio and MakerBot. There's, you know, NYU Polytech right down the street. I mean, there's movie studios. It's this, like, place that symbolizes America's past, but also, like, a rejuvenated future. So the messaging was dead on with the location of this. It was, from a debate perspective, it was inevitable that this debate was going to happen if the primaries got this far, but it was a really kind of boring debate. It was rancorous as far as this cycle's rhetoric has been. I mean, they were pretty aggressive with one another, at least far more than the first couple debates. But it wasn't anything like the level of the GOP. And that, I mean, that really... There is discord on the left, but it is just not analogous to what's going on with.
Oh, sweet Lord. No. I mean, anybody who thinks that is overblowing it. And I don't even think that the rancor on this in this election matches Obama Hillary in 2008. Yeah. You know,
no, not even close. I mean, you remember the You're Likable Enough event when Obama made that kind of dig at Hillary Clinton at the Philadelphia debate in 2007. And this is right. This is just nothing.
Even amongst the supporters, you know, there's not necessarily any kind of major unifying element of I'm never going to vote for this person or this person is permanently damaged. You know, if anything, Both.
Do you think that though? I mean, I think the Clinton supporters feel as though. How do you feel about the Sanders supporters? I feel like there's a. They don't. The level of dislike the Sanders supporters have for the Clinton team seems pretty high.
Yeah, like, but you want to know what? It seemed high. This to me reminds me. This is more analogous to supporters of like Newt Gingrich and Rick Santorum to Mitt Romney last cycle. That they don't like him. They think he's bought off. He represents a lot of things that they don't like about America, let alone their own party. But push comes to shove, better this person than the demon on the other side, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what it reminds me of. Now, for everybody on the left that is pointing and laughing at the Republican side, I think that next cycle, specifically, you know, if Hillary does not win the presidency, that you're going to see this is not here and gone. The fact that Bernie Sanders has tapped into something this strong, I think, is indicative of shifting issues in that electorate, and that's not going to go away, or at least it doesn't seem to me that it would go away, and you could see larger problems on the horizon. But I agree with you. Right now, it's not here. You know, the both of these supporters, I think, ultimately will coalesce around their nominee. The rancor has been certainly a lot less personal than it has been in the past, and or on the other side. But let me get to this point, because this is, I think, something that is personal with the Clinton camp specifically. The biggest thing to come out of it in terms of headlines, the debate that is, was the questioning about Israel. Now, this is notable on a few levels. The first, whenever Bernie Sanders has been asked about foreign policy, it has been by far his weakest subject in the debates. It has been by far Hillary Clinton's strongest subject, and she likes to really run up the point total in these kinds of questions by naming as many foreign dignitaries as she can, as if she gets to 12, she gets a free pizza. But this did not go the way that it normally goes. Bernie threads the stone needle on Israel, pointing out, despite the fact that Jewish defense hawks are very sensitive to anybody who says anything other than we fully stand behind Israel, says that the attacks on the West Bank have been excessive, and seems to do it in a way that says, hey, look, I'm Jewish. I can criticize Israel in a way that you, Hillary, can't. Hillary comes out very, very strong. And then in the next question, or maybe it might be in the question before, kind of trips up on Libya and Syria and kind of distances herself from the president, which she's been loath to do this entire primary process, as part of why she is very popular is preserving and furthering the Obama legacy. Did this stick out to you?
You're exactly right in terms of what Clinton's strategy has been, and that's to say, you know, the Obama presidency has been very successful. I was a significant part of that success, and it's running as an incumbent. And from what I understand, the Obama administration feels similarly about the Clinton campaign. She has always been more hawkish than many of her Democratic colleagues. She did vote for the Iraq war, and you know, she'll always be kind of saddled with that, but she's always been she's been a hawkish Democrat. There are different theories as to why that is, but I think that she is a pragmatist, or is running as a pragmatist, and this is kind of on message for it, saying, you know, look, here's the nitty gritty of what has to, like, you love it or lump it, this is the nitty gritty of what has to happen when you do foreign policy. You know, it's fine for my opponent to talk pie in the sky about stuff because he never wants to get in the weeds with what actually needs to be done in terms of getting deals done, getting policy and trade and all kinds of different foreign policy deals done I know how to do it. My opponent doesn't. And he shows his ignorance because he won't talk specifics. I would suspect that's the messaging they're trying to communicate.
Do you think, I mean, she certainly doesn't want to get into any situation where she is double-crossing the president, right? Like, that was a weak part of her debate performance, right?
I think there's, I didn't pick up on that as a weak part of the performance, but I think that, like, this is just not the time to, if there is a time to turn her back on the Obama team, it will also be done, or Obama administration decisions, it will be done strategically as well.
Yeah.
I think that, you know, there could be, let's just say, some really terrible things happen. And I'm sure that the establishment mainstream Democrats feel the same thing about her. You know, Bill could step in it and we may have to distance ourselves, but let's have a plan of action if and when that has to happen so that we do it strategically and we don't, like, shoot ourselves in the foot in the process. Maybe I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt, but I think that that's probably more likely than not the case.
Well,
that there's an understanding of, like, how to distance yourself.
Sure. Oh, of course. I mean, listen, I think that she knows where she wants to go on stuff, but she has, if there is a short part to her game, it is that she oftentimes can get wonky and she can get very, very defensive.
Yeah.
Speaking of defensive, let's focus on this. The Israeli-Palestinian conflict is not only something that is personal to many Democratic voters, although oftentimes it's far more sympathetic to the Palestinian side. It is a gigantic personal bugaboo for the Clintons, specifically Bill. Bill's number one regret, this is a quote from Bill Clinton, I'll read it here now. "My number one regret is I was not able to persuade Yasser Arafat to accept the peace plan that I offered at the end of my presidency that the Israelis accepted. If he had done that, we had 7 years of progress toward peace. We had 1 year in 1998, the only year in the history of Israel where not a single soul was killed in a terrorist act. The Palestinians had more control over the West Bank than they do today. And if they had taken that deal, we would have a Palestinian state that we would have had, I think, now normal, peaceful relations with Israel and a lot of its Arab neighbors." Folks, that's what he says on stage to a bunch of, I believe, car dealership owners. From what you can read behind the lines or what you have heard in the years since he left office, he is very rancorous toward Yasser Arafat for not taking this and, A, cementing his legacy. This was looked at as a legacy play for Bill Clinton at the end of his two terms in office. And I think if you were on the Bernie Sanders side and you wanted to provoke out-of-pocket, angry comments from Bill Clinton, for which in his recent past, he is very wont to do. He is wont to go off message and embarrass
recent
the campaign.
Past, his entire past.
This is what you pick. You pick at him on. You pick at him on, you know, hey, listen, they had 8 years to try and solve the Palestinian conflict. And just watch Bill start foaming at the mouth and just leap over whatever handler is desperately trying to push him back so he can get to a microphone and get all red-faced.
It's going to be great, man. It's going to it's like, I don't think we're going to come to this, but if this scenario happens, it'll be great.
If you were, I'm just saying, I'm not saying it'll happen. I'm saying if it were to happen, that would be the way to do it. But you want to know what? Let's take our eyes off New York for a second because it looks like, well, here, you want to know, before we do that, before we get into our pole dance, let's do final thoughts on the New York primary of as an astute follower. Do you think that we are in for any surprises? Obviously, Trump is way far ahead. The larger conversation there is exactly how many delegates he gets based on the congressional districts. On the Democratic side, much has been made of Bernie Sanders' closing of the gap. If you are a Bernie supporter, you have talked quite a bit about that. Do you think we are in for any surprises in the New York State primary?
In this campaign cycle, I can say with great certainty and authority, there will be no surprises. Who knows? I think it's going to be tight on... what baffles me about the New York primary is why John Kasich isn't performing a little better by, you know, at least recent performance and at least theories that seem to hold some water. You know, you'd think somebody who played well in the Rust Belt would also play well, at least upstate New York and a lot of, like, New York does have a ton of, you know, pretty centrist conservatives. And you'd think that would play well with John Kasich and definitely not Ted Cruz. And, you know, there's you would think that Donald Trump would have alienated plenty of people and that would help Kasich rise. Why that hasn't happened, I just don't know. That's the only real surprise that has kind of boggled me for a little while. But who knows what's going to happen this week. And then, you know, it's just one more crazy on a road of crazy that leads to, like, crazy town.
Certainly Cleveland. So. Well, I'll tell you what. Here's a state that John Kasich should do well in. And that is the subject of our pole dance. Ladies and gentlemen, why don't you go ahead, strap on that good suit. Not the really good suit, but the kind of good suit. You know, enough that you look, you know, kind of like a henchman in Miami Vice. Yeah, you know, go ahead. Get in your friend's car, because you're going to do a little drinking. Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, strap on that your car door, because
if you got that booty,
it's a pole dance. This is a Monmouth pole from April 10th to April 12th, sorry, in the great state of Pennsylvania, where John Kasich was born. A sample of 303 likely Republican voters, a margin of error of 5.6. We begin with our third place vote getter. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for the native son with a paltry 23%, John Kasich. Meanwhile, just ahead of him, enough to get the silver medal, but not enough to close the gap on our headliner. It is Ted, I swear his mouth is closed, Cruz, 28%. But looky, looky, this is the man. He might not know whether Joe Paterno is dead or not, but he's certainly sporting the famous number of the Syracuse Orangemen, fresh off a win in upstate New York. It is Donald J. Trump! Ladies and gentlemen, a spread of plus 16 for Trump in this Monmouth poll. Again, April 10th to the 12th. Now, the funny thing about Pennsylvania, which is something that I was kind of aware of, but I've been reading more about it as we get closer to it, Dan, is how ridiculous that primary is in general. You really only have, you have 71 delegates up, but only 17 are awarded to whoever wins.
It's, if ever there were a campaign cycle that illuminated the challenges both parties face in their nomination process, it is this cycle. I would suspect that the next big conversation we hear after the campaign, at least right under the current of mainstream, will be like the Democrats and Republicans have refined their nomination process. Because this, I don't know. I try to pay attention to this. It makes no sense to me. I don't know why they do it. It's their right to do it, but it seems a little batty.
Yeah. Well, so here's something that I want to talk about, and we wind up getting swamped by news and conversation, but I do just want to make this point, and it's something that, like, you know, I understand why Donald Trump is going to make a big issue of it, but let's understand the Republican and Democratic committees, they're not democracies. They never were democracies. They take votes very often in weird ways, but they are not a democracy any more than the Olive Garden is a democracy. You are going into a private club. Right. And then they are giving you a representative element, but it is very much, it is themed as representative democracy. It is not, and it never was. And it has no, there's not an onus on it to be that. Like, unless for whatever reason, the members of that club rose up as one and said, no, this has to be a little bit clearer than it is now. But what you are seeing is the result of years and years and years and years and years of people tweaking the rules because they see things going, you know, in different ways. It is very much like, here, listen, if you are complaining, the same people who complain about the process are the same people who complain about the Facebook algorithm. Like, it's there for a reason, and you're going to have to either trust the creators for those reasons or just not participate in it because it has no reason to listen to what you say about it. It is a private club. Is that too harsh?
No, that's it. It is. Well, I mean, these are private organizations and they can do what they want. But I think that we're already hearing these noises come out of the Trump campaign. And as we get closer to the conventions, that's one of his arguments. If he doesn't get the delegate count, he's going to say, you know, look, this private club, not private club, we're talking about the president of the United States. You know, I got, you know, the vast majority of delegates. All right, I didn't hit this like random number they chose, but like clearly I'm the winner of this process and they're trying to take it away from me. And I think that that appeals to this really basic sense of fairness that people have, right? You know, private club or not private club, a lot of people may be sitting there going, well, especially if he can be disciplined, if he can keep the crazy at bay for long, for like just keep like, don't alienate people for a little while and they may forget. Who knows?
It blows me. And I know I'm just going back to this. I've said this over and over again. I'm a broken record. Everybody listening to me will just, you know, just copy paste every rant I've had about this before. It blows me away that he went right back to Lion Ted after Florida.
Yeah.
Like right. Just he's no threat. Just say right. We won. Me and Ted Cruz beat the establishment. Like, that's, yeah. And then just play it out. Play out the rest of them. You're going to win. It's over.
I think you're so, the metaphor of when a player makes, this is like the Bill Buckner of politics, right? Like you don't, you don't really have a favorite team or a favorite side, but man, when that ball skits through your legs, it was such an easy play, man.
It was so easy.
Easy play.
I'll tell you what. Here's something that's very, very easy. Getting in touch with us. You can hit us up on Twitter, at Justin R. Young. We went to Twitter questions this week. Normally, we've done email questions because we've had such good emails. You can always still send those in, justinrobertyoung@gmail.com. Put politics in the subject line so I know what the hot hell you're talking about. But we got great Twitter questions. We'll start with this one. Tyler, do you think that there are potential running mates for, or what do you think the potential running mates are for each remaining candidate? Here's my favorite thing about Twitter questions. You can only have 140 characters. I'm so excited about taking more Twitter questions. You said that you had some thoughts on this. Dan, who do you think?
You know, there have been, I don't know. I actually have really no idea what will happen if we see some crazier scenarios play out. Like, what if there's a Trump, Sanders? What happens? You know, the Democrats have kind of had this deep bench for a while, but their like farm system is kind of rising to the top. Not all the players are making it, but some of them are. There's all this talk about Julian Castro. I think he'd be pretty likely. Some liberal groups don't like him, but I think if Hillary is the nominee,
for Hillary.
Yeah, I think if Hillary's the nominee, Julian Castro is a strong contender. On the other side, there's
so he is the current HUD secretary.
Yeah. I think the Republicans would just be crazy not to nominate a woman or a minority or something that says, look, we're not entirely jerks to everybody. We kind of get it. I'm not being fair to the Republican Party as a whole, or to conservatives.
Let's break this down a little bit more granularly and say, what does each candidate have to fill in? Because normally what happens is either you are picking somebody from a state you want to win that on your map makes it more likely that you are going to win that state, or you have somebody that fills in for a weakness in the candidate heading into the general, because this is pretty much the last patch you get on this code. So for Obama, Joe Biden brought an ability to connect with Congress and experience specifically in terms of foreign policy to an inexperienced president, right?
Yep.
What does Hillary need?
Hillary needs to hit some demographic profiles. Like everybody needs to do the things that you just said. And those are moving targets depending on what the campaign cycle is. It's kind of like, if you game, you're familiar with the concept of min-maxing.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like they're all trying to min-max the best build possible.
Yeah.
And sometimes you miss, right? You make the wrong choice. And that was John McCain in 2008, right? It wasn't that he was being stupid or not strategic. It's just that, like, oh, crap, I chose the wrong gear, the wrong build or whatever, and damn, I'm on the wrong path. So I think that for the Democrats, they have to get somebody who brings some youthful energy. You know, one of the constant complaints of the Hillary Clinton campaign is that she doesn't bring the passion that the Sanders people bring. And so that's a legitimate critique. She has to find that somewhere. You know, she has to bring the Sanders, Elizabeth Warren, more extreme parts of the Democratic Party along with her. And she has to show that she can unite the party and also be a serious leader that connects with at least centrist conservatives. The Republicans have to do the exact opposite of that and show that they're not insane. I mean, the onus is on them now to show, hey, we went through a rocky nomination process, but you know what? The base is strong. Republican ideals are strong. We nominated a candidate that we can get behind, and we chose a VP that shores up that candidate's weaknesses, however that candidate needs to be shored up. I think Nikki Haley from South Carolina would just be – she sounds so good on paper. I have a hard time thinking she wouldn't be chosen by almost any of the Republican potential nominees. The Republican bench is not quite as strong as the Democratic bench, but it's, you know, who knows?
So what? I mean, you would look at in terms of big famous or and this is politician famous, not real famous. You would say what? Nikki Haley, Mia Love, like these are the names of women in power on the Republican side. I think that would be an interesting pick. I think Trump doesn't necessarily need to.
Man, who knows what he's going to do?
I mean, Trump needs an anchor. Trump needs somebody that you say, oh, okay, well, Trump can be Trump, but there's another person that's actually going to, you know, be president. You know, that's
an adult in the room.
There's somebody else on the ticket that makes you say, that makes you look twice at Donald Trump and say, oh, well, I mean, if this guy's cool with him, then maybe, you know, he's got the idea, especially because he's put a lot of stake into saying, I'm going to bring in the best people, the best, the biggest chip that he has to offer is the vice presidency. If he can't reel in a big name as vice president, then you kind of look a bit like a fraud, which
what do you think
has a tendency. I mean, I think for him. Here's the other problem, and the reason why I'm so frustrated by it is because I think he could have pulled a big name if he would have acted like an adult when he had won the nomination instead of being a petulant child tweeting about television 24/7. So I don't know. I mean, I really don't know who wants to hinge their political career on Donald Trump. Like, I have no – it is a gigantic question mark for me with that. I think – Nikki Haley is a great choice for Ted Cruz.
Yeah.
Because she is a strong person, a strong voice that can say, hey, look, you can't run the same War on Women campaign that you ran against Mitt Romney when Nikki Haley's likeable on the ticket. Very likable, popular in her state, and somebody
policy
that
chops.
Yeah, that I think can also sharpen up her elbows and be the attack dog, which is very often what the vice presidential nominee can do. As far as Hillary, I think Julian Castro is an interesting idea. Cory Booker, to me, is a very interesting idea for her.
Yeah, I think this is not Booker's time, and I think he knows that. He's been very smart and, like, really understated since becoming a senator, and I think that, like, he doesn't bring New Jersey. That she's got.
I mean, that's – listen, Cory Booker's a very smart guy.
Yeah, he is.
If Hillary Clinton is running against Donald Trump, that is about as good an odds as you are going to get into the White House.
It's a really, it's a sexy ticket.
I mean,
Clinton Booker's a sexy ticket, and they got to know this.
And he is an enthusiastic surrogate for them. You know, he has been there to be he has been instrumental in helping cement some of the black vote, which is a huge part of their coalition. I think he's an interesting idea. Rob,
I think he is.
Writes, do you think Trump supporters will riot after he is not picked on the first ballot? So let's assume that Rob is not from the future and would be able to answer his own question, since he is assuming that Trump will not be picked on the first ballot. But I will be in Cleveland. Are you going to be in Cleveland, Dan?
Yeah, I'll see you there, man.
Are we going to have to, soak our handkerchiefs in vinegar to avoid the tear gas as we make our way from the media pen to the hotel?
Yeah. I think it is. Look, there will be protests. There's always protests. The extent to which there will be protests, the city of Cleveland has invested something like $20 million into riot gear. Yeah. So I think they are, if you want to use an economic indicator, I think that their investment may presage something. But who knows? It could be very civil. But I wear glasses, so I bring an extra pair of glasses in case something gets broken,
So here's my thought on this has always been
elbow that, to the nose,
especially now that we're already seeing the Trump campaign pivot a little bit on this, that a lot of the anger will kind of be played out a little bit before we actually get to the first ballot.
Well, let's hope so. I mean,
because I think he's going to say, I'm not going to win. And we'll start to see some of that play out. If he's not close and it's very clear that the clamps are on, and he's not close enough to flip, whatever juice that Kasich can bring, or let's say, a Hail Mary of getting both, Kasich and having a Trump Rubio ticket or something, where he's able to finagle 1237. I think that we'll the writing will be on the wall before we get to Cleveland. But will Trump supporters riot? I don't know. I really don't know whether or not they are necessarily like the rioting type. They are certainly they have the propensity to. And this is I also kind of hesitate to just do broad generalizations because I think it's irresponsible what Trump said on stage in terms of violent stuff. But I think that's more of a reflection on him than a broad swath of literally anybody who finds any value in Donald Trump that they are, for whatever reason, violent. I think that's unfair. But I don't know. I think that, yes, there will be protests. I don't know if it's just going to be like bash out windows, violent rioting.
I don't know that it'll be that. I think it's like anytime you get. It's like ABC, always be cool. Anytime you get like a big group of excitable people together and there's a sense of grievance and maybe you take some physical factors, like you've been protesting for a while, so you're hungry and you're tired. It's like, and then you mix in police who are often there just to do their job and be good people. But, sometimes the two don't.
Well, you get frustrated. I mean, listen, between the statistical fact that there are indeed some cops who gets overzealous, and also that's a crap job, man. That's a crap detail. Standing out there in the hot sun on your feet and dealing with people screaming and spitting at you, like that's rough, man. You think going through the TSA is bad? You try being a riot cop.
I tell you though, I in my experience, it is absolutely true. I've always found I've seen police do some zany things. But I've always found protesters to be far more volatile and violent. I mean, I got punched in the gut in the 2008 RNC by a protester who tried to steal my credential. I mean, like these, like often you get people who are not homogenous. It's not like all one group of people. It's like, and a couple mischief makers. It's like, it's not like all cops are bad. Not all protesters are bad.
No.
But a couple mischief makers with protesters can just set things into a really like bad place.
For which I've seen, and politically, I would say personally, I have seen far more in, and this isn't even like mainstream political protests, but this is more like, you know, a radical anti-capitalist, you know, kinds of protesters, not necessarily protests, that, you know, there are organized elements that are there to be anarchists. Like, they're not there to raise a sign. They're there to be cloaked by a bunch of people so they can put on black masks and throw bricks. Like,
have you done those?
I have. Yeah, no, I've covered a few protests in New York City and, you know, listen, you know enough people to know where the black bloc people are. And if you're friendly enough with the protest people, you know where to stay away from them. So they do exist. James writes, why do you think that Hillary Clinton is hiding from the media, not answering questions recently? Do you think that Hillary will be indicted by Obama's Department of Justice if the FBI requests it? Let's take this one at a time. Do you think Hillary Clinton has been overly cautious?
Everybody's been overly cautious. It's just that's a functional role of being a politician.
Unless you're Donald Trump, which it makes him so crazy, is that like literally you are an abundance of his opinions.
Yeah.
I don't think that. I mean, Hillary Clinton, yes, she's hiding, but like
cautious,
they all
politician.
Do. Like, well, geez, I mean, if only someone would write a joke about that. For those of you who don't know, I can't believe. All right, we got to actually play this. We got to actually. We got to actually play this clip. I can't believe. I can't believe that we did not that we did not have this queued up. So here we go. This is Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton rather, and Mayor de Blasio of New York City. Do you remember what? Do you know what function this was?
Yeah.
What function was it?
I will say, like, I need to recuse myself from making any kind of. Any kind of commentary about this. This was at an event called Inner Circle, which is a correspondence dinner. We have it at the UN. It's at the White House. There's one for City Hall called Inner Circle. And at all of these events, it's like they make bad jokes. The press make bad jokes. The politicians make bad jokes. It's part of the culture of these events. They're also loaded with people who like really legitimately work together, but are also sometimes big names that you will recognize. And so they're kind of in close, it's Inner Circle for a reason. It's not like it's a conspiracy. It's just like you want to let your hair down sometimes.
Sure.
And when you're constantly under public scrutiny, it's like you just want to
want to cut loose. You get Aaron Burr from the hit musical Hamilton.
Yeah, so my significant other works as a spokeswoman for the mayor, and I mean, it was funny, not funny, but like, I don't want to go.
All right, then we're not going to talk about it. We're just going to play it, and we will move on.
Right. You totally can. I'm just like
understood. And by the way, please, if you have not heard this, the squirming that Dan is doing right now, prepare to do in your seat just out of awkwardness. Understand if you are only listening to this on audio, what is on stage is the actor whose name escapes me is this not the actual thing? Oh, here we go, yeah. The actor who plays Aaron Burr in the hit musical Hamilton, Hillary Clinton, resplendent in a gold suit, and Mayor de Blasio, who always shocks me at how tall he is. They are on stage, and this is what unfolds.
To say thanks for the endorsement, Bill. Took you long enough.
Oh, sorry, Hillary. I was running on CP time.
That's not, I don't like jokes like that, Bill. That's not funny.
Cautious politician time.
That's why I made that joke. It was like, it's the kind of thing where you just shouldn't tell jokes like that when you are in rooms that are decked with cell phones. But like, there was no—I don't think there was any.
Well, this was a mounted camera. This wasn't even a cell phone. It's not even like this one got uploaded from somebody's 6S, right? Like, this was it was there to be recorded for posterity. Listen, all right. I think Its embarrassment as a political artifact kind of stands for itself. I will criticize it now as a joke writer. If you were going to write that joke, right. you say cautious politician time first.
Exactly.
And then have somebody else say CP time.
It's right. It's just like watching the bad when politicians mess up and you're pissed at the game.
Yeah.
It's like you're a writer, so you understand this. It's like, man, if you're going to do that, do it right.
Yeah, at least, and also don't have either of those two people say the word. Have them say cautious politician time and then have the Aaron Burr. Like, I mean, listen, this is going to sound coarse. You have a black guy on stage. Why are the white people making the racial jokes? Like, there's no reason to do it. All right, here we go. Derek writes, after recent primary turnout and possible contested conventions, when the status quo wins, what will the general look like? So I guess, do you think here, over under 0.5, how many contested conventions do you think we are going to have by the time that we get to our general election? More simply put, do you think we will have one contested convention?
Yeah, there's the Democrats would be. I mean, who knows? Maybe crazy. But it's not going to happen on the Democrat side.
No,
it seems likely to happen on the Republican side right now.
Yeah, I would say yes. I think we're going to get one. We're going to get a multi-ballot convention, and it's going to be on the Republican side. I think Bernie. At some point, Bernie's going to have to cash out. And Bernie will cash out with far more cachet than he has ever had prior. He is going to be able to say, hey, listen, I've kept it civil with Hillary for a very, very long time. There's a reason why. She's going to make a great president. I'm going to be her surrogate. We're going to get really excited about it. He's going to give a great speech at the DNC convention in Philadelphia. And that'll be fine. And you want to know what? Everybody's going to remember those halcyon days when everybody hated each other and focus on the fact that either Trump or Cruz are running because they are both suitable boogeymen for the Democrats. As for the Republican one, woo! I don't know.
Fun time in Cleveland.
It's going to be a fun time. My heart, my gut, rather, it says this is going to be Cruz versus Clinton. And
yeah.
I think that that's what it's Me going too. To be. And I think it's going to be close. I think it is going to be closer than people think because both of them, for whatever damage they either have going in or have taken during that convention, they will be able to point to a boogeyman on the other side and say, yeah, but you want to put them in the White House? And that will be compelling to both sides.
Yeah, I think you're right. And all of this should be under the banner of, like, I don't care. I don't know what you feel, but I see the game being played. I don't care. I don't have a horse in the race. What I care about is, like, the happiness and betterment of all people. And beyond that, like, I want to see a game played well.
Sure, yes. And you are a very, very good man for having those in that order, because I'm definitely...
I just don't have the
energy. I want to watch a good game. If it happens to ruin civilization, hey, whatever.
It's a good game.
I want a good game. W. Scott is one in the chat room, says, the Republican establishment doesn't want Trump or Cruz. It'll be Kasich or somebody else. Listen, if the establishment were getting what they wanted in this primary, we would be lauding the amazing ascension of Jeb Bush and exalting the Bush dynasty as it puts in its third president. We are out of the realm where the establishment gets to pick who they want. At this point, if you see by endorsements, Cruz is their pick over Kasich. And Cruz has more of a second ballot chance because of how hard he's hustled for those delegates. And finally, Rob writes, what's the chances of a current leading candidate, i.e. Trump or Clinton, and then he had Sanders in there too, running as a third party in the general? Rank them in order of likelihood to run as a third party, Trump, Clinton, and Sanders, Dan.
Trump is 50-50, I think. I really don't know, and I would imagine that they don't know. Sanders and Clinton, no, there's no chance. There's no chance.
Sure. Sanders more likely than Clinton, as he has been an independent for most of his career.
Yeah, but no chance. I mean, like, he doesn't want to actually wound the Democratic Party. He is an issues candidate, or appears to be an issues candidate. I'm not trying to disparage him, but I mean, this has been an issues campaign for him, and that is, some would say, a very healthy sign, or a sign of a healthy Democratic Party, that they're able to have a robust discussion that sometimes gets aggressive, but is also resilient, and will. This is probably the party line that will make them stronger in the end. We're not seeing, again, it's not analogous on the Republican side. This is something that is an existential, not threat, crisis. And who the heck knows? I think probably the strongest course of action, and again, this isn't favoritism. I just think, like, if I'm a Republican strategist, what do I want? I want something that keeps my party together, and we can say, well, this thing that happened with Donald Trump was really... you know, it's something that happened, but it doesn't define the Republican Party, and we're going to go forward with other candidates and other elections, and we're going to behave like a normal party. And if I'm doing that, then I do what you just said. I nominate Ted Cruz, or the party nominates Ted Cruz, and there are even some people in the Republican Party who are saying it is kind of a joke, and I think this is small whispers, but they say lose with Cruz, better to lose with Cruz than it is to really rend our party apart and do stuff that we don't stand for with Donald Trump. But who knows? Who knows? It could.
But all right, so Trump, but the argument for Trump running as a third party is that, listen, he's not a politician, so, you know, he really is only nominally a member of the Republican Party.
What's he got? What's the stakes for him? You know, what's he got to lose? Like, nothing.
Well, I mean, you have the chance that you installed Hillary Clinton. That would be the bugaboo.
Does he care? Does he really care?
I mean, you know, some might say that he would, that this is the plan that he, I mean, like, you know, it is not a secret that him and Hillary kind of got along before this whole process. You know, that they were people. I mean, Trump very famously is somebody who is a friend maker, a powerful friend maker, and the Clintons were certainly listed among them. So, but we won't need to indulge in, you know, kind of super crazy conspiracy theories. I don't think he wants to be Ross Perot, but then again, I think after Florida, I officially just cashed out of the Trump prediction business. Like, yeah. I don't know if I could ever say it. My gut says that he would rather be, if he's bested, he would rather play kingmaker and say, you want to know what? Cruz is a guy who got it done. I always support winners. Cruz is a winner. He's going to win. And then if Cruz wins, Donald Trump's the one who did it. And if Cruz loses, then like, oh my God. And then he just, you know, cut and replace Mitt Romney with Ted Cruz with how he talks about Mitt Romney now. You know, so I think that would be the playbook that I think he would run from. But, you know, here's the other reason is that I don't think he's going to run for third party because he doesn't like spending money. Like, he's run this campaign kind of on a threadbare budget. And I don't know whether or not he wants to run a national campaign without any support from the party for president. So who knows? Dan, thank you so much for joining us. This has gone a little bit longer than it normally does, but I very much appreciate you hanging out with us. Where can people find more of your political wisdom?
Ah, man, thanks a ton for having me. I rarely get to talk about politics itself, so it's a ton of fun. I'm just on Twitter at Dan Patterson. Pretty easy.
Well, thank you again. Super fun time, and hopefully we'll get to have you on a little bit more before we begin as we continue through this election season. I'm very excited to bring you and many more people on, and definitely I'll see you in Cleveland. Folks, if you would like to email the show, it is justinrobertyoung@gmail.com, by the contender at thecontender.us. Music, as always, provided by Valesco and Dropkillers. And you can follow me at Justin R. Young everywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, some shows talk about politics, others talk about politics. This is the only show that really talks about politics. See you next week.
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.